Advocate V.T. Walavalkar lecture series. This is a series of lectures organized and conducted by the Akhil Bharatiya Adhivakta Parishad in association with the Advocates Association of Western India. Now, today's topic of the lecture is unauthorized constructions and dilapidated buildings under municipal laws. We are well aware of the problem of unauthorized construction and dilapidated buildings in the city of Mumbai at least. And we are well aware of the enormous amount of litigation that is prevalent because of these two problems that we face day in and day out. So, to begin with, first, let me just talk to you about a little bit about Adhivakta Parishad. Although the Adhivakta Parishad has been in existence for many years, its work and efforts to better the society in general and us lawyers in particular is not so well known. So I call upon Mrs. Anjali Ahegar, President of the Mumbai Division Unit, to introduce us to the Adhivakta Parishad and its work.
I am here to give a brief introduction of Akhil Bharatiya Adhivakta Parishad. I am sure that many of you have heard this before, but I will mention this about the Adhivakta Parishad once again for the benefit of those who have come for the first time. Akhil Bharatiya Adhivakta Parishad is an organization of advocates registered in the year 1992 with the efforts of great visionary Shri Dattopanta Thengdi along with some others, and it has started with the motto Nyayaha Mama Dharmaha. Adhivakta Parishad aims to work for betterment of advocates, betterment of the society, and to reach to every section of the society. We undertake different projects like Nyaya Prabha. We run a magazine quarterly issue in which different articles are given. We conduct lecture series, we conduct workshops. I invite all of you to participate in this program in big numbers. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anjali Madam. And now I call upon Ms. Dhanashri Bhate to introduce us to today's speaker, although he needs no introduction.
Thank you, Neha Madam. Good evening all. It's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Senior Advocate, Mr. Sakhare Sir. Sakhare Sir is a leading constitutional practicing for last 43 years. He has a large practice on diverse subjects, including constitutional, environmental and economic law. Due to his outstanding performance at the bar, he was elevated to the bench of the Bombay High Court as additional judge in 1997. In 1998, he resigned as an additional judge of the High Court and resumed practice at the bar. Since last 20 years, Mr. Sakhare is practicing as a designated senior counsel, having been designated as a senior counsel in 1999 by the Bombay High Court. Mr. Sakhare is a senior counsel for various municipal corporations including Mumbai, Pune, Thane and Nashik, the Indian Medical Council, and is regularly appointed by various departments of the state government, inter alia including home, urban development, cooperative and education. In the last more than 42 years as a lawyer, Mr. Sakhare has appeared in number of landmark cases of general and public importance. Mr. Sakhare is one of the leading counsel for educational institutions, inter alia including matters regarding approval, recognition and seat allocations from the Medical Council of India. His vast experience can also be seen in matters of criminal proceedings. His standing at the bar recognition by Honorable Bombay High Court by appointing him as an amicus curiae in several matters and even being requested to act as a mediator in several sensitive cases. We are grateful for your presence amongst us today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anashri. Now I request Sakhare Sir to begin his lecture, please.
Before my learned senior begins, let us felicitate him for his contribution.
I request Mr. Chandrakant sir to felicitate Sakhare sir.
Good evening everybody. I thank the conveners for inviting me to address this gathering on the subject of unauthorized construction and dilapidated building under municipal laws. My role mainly will be placing both the issues, both the points before this gathering to enable you to understand the intercities and what are the issues which the plaintiff or petitioner can take and what the defense advocate can take. I would like to open with a quote which has been referred by Honorable Mr. Justice Oak in his judgment, whereby he upheld the constitutional validity of Section 52A of MRTP Act. The quote originally authored by Greek philosopher, by far the greatest and the most admirable form of wisdom is that needed to plan and beautify the cities and human communities. One of the problems that has faced most of the urban agglomeration in the country is menace of illegal and unauthorized construction. Issue is not limited to only slums or payment dwellers, but it extends to large-scale developers, builders, landlords that are multi-story buildings without any proper permissions and sanctions. In these unauthorized multi-story buildings that are not only difficult to pull down, but also put a serious burden on the infrastructure, therefore have grave and serious impact on larger interest. Justice A.P. Mishra, the then judge of the Supreme Court, while dealing with the constitutional validity of a provision of Tamil Nadu Act, whereby all unauthorized constructions up to a particular date were regularized, has said, and I quote, "Unless check at the nascent stage is made for which it is for the state to consider what administrative schemes is to be evolved, which it may be difficult to control this progressive illegality. If such illegalities stay for long, a wave of political, humanitarian, regional and other sympathies develop, then to break it may become difficult. Thus, this inflow has to be checked at every root. State must act effectively not to permit such situation to develop in the wider interest of the public at large." Justice Oak, while accepting the state amendment to Section 50 to MRTP by Section 52A, whereby some structures throughout Maharashtra prior to certain date were regularized, has said that ultimately illegal structures are creating imbalance and creating burden on the infrastructures, the corporations, councils, and thereby Article 21 is offended. I will come to that judgment in little later. First, I will take this as we are in Mumbai about the some of the provisions of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act and some of the provisions which are relevant for the purposes of our present today's subject under the Maharashtra Regional Town Planning Act. Section 337 of the Act, MCGM Act, requires that any person wants to make development has to give intention, notice of his of erecting the building. Section 342, notice is given, required to be given to the commissioner if any person wants to make any additions, alterations or change of user in the existing buildings. Exception is carved out in Section 342, which says that in case of tenantable repairs, the permission of the corporation is not necessary, nor you should go to the corporation or apply to the corporation for such permissions. As the time is short, I will only quote the section so that it can be noted. Section 342 requires any change of user, addition or alteration in the existing building, notice is required to be given to the commissioner. But exception is carved out regarding tenantable repairs, such as changing the roof by the same material, removing the floor and replacing the from other material. With these are some exceptions which are to be looked into under 342. Printed form is available under section 344. I am giving this data because once a notice under 351 is issued, what is required to be looked into by the parties, by the advocate. For that purpose, this basic, some foundation will be necessary. So that printed form notice is required to be given to the commissioner about intention to develop or intention to make addition or alteration or change of user on the existing building. After permission is granted, under section 347, work can commence. During the completion of the work, section 350 authorizes the MCGM or any corporation, some different sections will be there, to visit the building, to inspect the building when work is going on. Then comes section 351. Section 351 authorizes the corporation to take action against the illegal constructions made, illegal addition or alterations made, or change of user of a particular building. It will cover entire new building being constructed. Also, it will cover where addition, alterations are made without proper permission, and even change of user, such as residential building, residential flat is made commercial, vice versa, or commercial is used for some other industrial use, etc. This 351 is being interpreted by our division bench way back in 1996. There was a case from Pune, a famous case, Sopan Maruti Thoptes case it is called. It is reported in 1996, 1 MLJ 963. I am giving this reference of this judgment because recently Supreme Court has occasion to consider this judgment one month back itself. And they have said that this judgment says what says should be made applicable except one direction. The matter came before the Supreme before the High Court by way of reference. And after considering various arguments from the private parties, landlords, and the municipal corporation, even municipal Mumbai Municipal Corporation or party, in para 19 of that judgment, the division bench has given certain directions. These directions will be relevant, therefore just I will quote these directions, because this will be the directions where any party approaches the advocate saying that I have received 351 notice, what is my status, what I should do. In para 19, the High Court has said, and I quote, in every case where notice under section 351 of BMC Act or under 260 of BPMC Act is issued to a party, 15 days time shall be given for submitting reply. In the case, the party to whom notice is issued sends the reply with the documents and show cause, the municipal commissioner or deputy municipal commissioner shall consider the reply, and if no sufficient cause is shown, give short reason for not accepting the contention of the affected party. In this, there is some departure recently made by the Supreme Court, which I just now said this Supreme Court has recently visited it. Section 351 is amended in 2013, and the section 351(1) requires that 7 days notice should be given and party should be heard. Before 1991-99, only notices were given and actions were taken. There was no procedure of hearing the affected party, no procedure of giving opportunity to place their material on record, nor even the material to permit the advocates of the party to represent in person. And they used to come and demolish. So this judgment tries to put a system in place so that some checks and are put upon the authorities who are taking actions, So also the persons who are taking action, making illegal construction. Direction number 2 says it would be open to the commissioner to demolish the offending structure 15 days after the order of the commissioner, deputy commissioner, is communicated to the parties. This is written by the Supreme Court recently also, saying that as section doesn't permit or gives any time, therefore 15 days time is available to you for approaching the court of law. While coming to 351 procedure, when notice is given, notice has to be in detail, must pinpoint what are the nature of alterations, addition or illegal construction made by the party, and generally map is given to, along with that notice, a sketch is given. The affected party to whom notice is given, generally it should be landlord, stroke occupier. There is one judgment of Justice Lodha, it's unreported, I could not get that copy. Justice Lodha has said way back in 1996 that a notice to the landlord should be must. If notice is not given to the landlord, that notice is bad. But I could not get that copy. I have the citation, I can give it to you. The designated officers are appointed to hear and decide the illegalities. So landlord of affected party has to represent by its written submissions and give the documents in support. In each and every case, hearing may not be necessary. It will depend on facts of each case and discretion of the designated officer whether to give personal hearing or not. After that, the designated officer is supposed to pass speaking order. Speaking order contemplates the application of mind and consideration of the objections raised by the landlord or the affected party. Some departure at this stage, section 515A was introduced and suits were barred. When the challenge came before this court saying that this is give unguided powers and there is no remedy of appeal, therefore that section should be struck down. The division being presided over by Justice Chandrachud upheld the validity, saying that there are sufficient safeguards provided in the section itself. In that context, I am giving this information that what 351 contemplates, what is supposed to be done by the designated officer, and what are the rights available to the affected party to whom notice is given. After the 15 days notice, etc., demolition can take place. The direction number 3 relates to how if the unauthorized construction being found in progress, what is the authority supposed to do? Direction number 3 says, in the case the staff of the corporation detects the building which is being processed or being constructed and or reconstructed and or extended without valid permission from the corporation, it will be open to the commissioner to demolish the same by giving short notice of 24 hours after drawing a panchnama at the site and also by taking photographs of such structure and or extension. The photograph should indicate the date when the same were taken. So this enables the authority to have a record with it before notice is given, because they have to check it whether the structure is authorized, alteration, additions are being made, whether are they permissible, etc. So that the panchnama, photographs, etc., record is required to be maintained. For your information, generally these panchanamas or photographs are not maintained, where the advantage can be taken saying that this procedure is not followed, because this is for last 20 years this judgment is operating, and recently Supreme Court has approved this, saying that rest of the directions given in Sopan Maruti's case should be made applicable for the purposes of taking actions. Direction number 4 says that in case where municipal corporation has followed due process of law and demolished the unauthorized structure or extension, if the same is reconstructed without valid permission within a period of 1 year, it would also be open to the corporation to demolish the same by giving short notice of 24 hours. So after the action is taken, of demolition has taken place, if reconstructionist notice that within 24 hours notice can be given, and within 24, after 24 hours that structure can be demolished. Then direction number 4 is an oral hearing, therefore I must point out to this to you. If the offending structure and or extension which is assessed by the corporation for 2 years, notice shall provide for 15 days time to show cause. If the deputy municipal commissioner comes to the conclusion that he requires assistance of the party, he may give an oral hearing if he deems fit and proper before passing the order. It is made clear that oral hearing is not at all compulsory, but it is the discretion of the authority. While giving replies to the show cause notices or notices given under 351 or 354A, you must add a line that personal hearing should be given because I can represent my case properly, documents I can explain properly, and that will enable the authorities to arrive at a proper conclusion. Then direction number 6, last direction. In any case, the corporation is directed to issue show cause notice in case of any structure and or extension other than those mentioned in clause 1 to 4 above. The corporation shall provide 7 days notice of show cause in such cases. So this Sopan Maruti's case is recently approved by the Supreme Court. Citation, it is not yet reported, but it is on online available. 2019 SSC online SC 1389. It is judgment of Deepak Gupta, delivered on October 24, 2019, very recently. That matter went from this High Court, where this High Court directed restoration of the structure. While examining the scheme, provisions etc. are quoted by the Supreme Court, and para 17 and 18, para 9, 14, Sopan Maruti is quoted as, I am just giving citation, I don't want to go in detail. Sopan Maruti is quoted, at one stage they have said, the direction number 1 will not be valid because section is amended, rest of the directions are valid directions and they should be followed. That can be found in para 11 and para 14. The Supreme Court has said that the High Court's directing reconstruction of the structure which is demolished by the authorities without following due process, that practice is duplicated, saying that the High Court should not have exercised the power under Article 2 to 6 to grant restoration of a structure which is unauthorized. So ultimately what High Court, Supreme Court felt that what High Court is doing is permitting unauthorized construction to come up by the order passed by the High Court. That they have said such action should not be, such direction should not be given. In para 17 and 18, the Supreme Court has said in such cases, High Court can direct compensation, payment of compensation for taking such type of action without following due process of law. Thus, this Sopan Maruti case for the purposes of 351 and similar provisions of the Maharashtra Municipal Corporation Act, so also the other Municipal Councils Act, will be relevant, and Sopan Maruti's case is still applicable after 20 years also. One case of Supreme Court, it is Munis Surwat Swami Jain SMP Son, 2006, 8 SSC 590, and making this reference of the judgment for the purposes of section 351 or other sections and other laws, Maharashtra Municipal Corporation Act or other acts, gives discretion to the commissioner means designated officer, can come to a conclusion that structure is illegal. The addition alterations are made are illegal, change of user is illegal. Still, he can exercise his discretion and say that I don't want to take action of demolition. Supreme Court saying that if the such discretion is used by the designated officer or the commissioners, then High Court in its jurisdiction cannot substitute its opinion to that discretion. Important aspect of the judgment will be, the Supreme Court is informing us, or law laid down by the Supreme Court, is that Section 3, power under Section 351 is exercisable only by the municipal commissioner, who, after issuing a show cause notice and after examining the cause shown, has the discretion to order or not the order of demolition of the alleged unauthorized structure. High Court can, in exercise of its jurisdiction, impede by mandatory order the exercise of such discretion. So this can be used while making replies, that all right, there may be something, but it is not affecting other parties, adjoining persons, not affecting infrastructure, etc. It is a minor in nature and it can be condoned, and you should not take an action. For that purpose, this judgment can be used by us. Then we come to Section 354, and thereafter I will come to the suit, maintainability of the suit. Section 354A of the Act gives authority power to intervene when the construction is on. That power can, that power is exercised when construction is noticed, when construction is in progress. The inquiry is made, the person who is carrying out that construction asks about the permission. If permission is not shown, notice is given. Same directions given by Sopan Maruti's case are required to be followed. But time limit is 24 hours. Within 24 hours, landlord or person has to give reply. If reply is given, short order, reason order is passed, and action is dropped or action is taken. If no reply is given within 24 hours, action can be taken. Same procedure as required to be followed under 351. So 351, 354A are about illegal constructions. And taking action against the unauthorized constructions. The MRTP Act also provides that action can be taken. First, it provides that how the permissions are to be sought for. Then MRTP says that if it is noticed that something is illegal found, how the actions are to be taken. And some provisions I quote, so that when we are considering the bar of jurisdiction under the Municipal Corporation Act, particularly in Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, so also Maharashtra Regional Town Planning Act, I can deal with that subject of bar of jurisdiction at one stage. The MRTP's first object, we must understand the why illegalities, etc., are not recognized by the High Court and Supreme Court and not tolerated. Object of MRTP is plan development, use of the land, constitution of regional boards, preparation of the development plans, execution of the town planning schemes, to establish new authorities, and to provide for compulsory acquisition. Plan MRTP Act, the development control regulations are base for a infrastructure or a development of the cities, urban, semi-urban or villages in a proper mode, where the citizens can have their shelters and they can live peacefully. That has to be looked into along with Article 21 and 48, because principle of sustainable development and precautionary principle, as a state has to protect, improve the environment and also guard the forests and wildlife. Chapter 4 is regarding the development and use of the land included in the development plan. Just brief summary of sections. Section 44 of the MRTP, you apply for development permissions. Section 45 is grant or refusal of the development permissions. Section 46 is that while granting or refusing the permission, you should have due regard to the proposed draft development plan. Suppose draft development plan is coming and some landlord applies for development, then while granting or refusing permission, the authority has to look into what will be the proposed, what is contained in the draft development plan, whether that development plan permits such type of development. Therefore, due regard to the proposed development plan is the language used. If there is a refusal of permission, 47 is an appeal, then 51, section 51 is power of the authority to revoke the development permissions. This section is interpreted by Justice Chandrachud in Kohinoor's case. Issue is at what stage such permissions can be withdrawn. Court has held where there is substantial development has taken place, then in that case development permissions can be revoked. Citation is the Kohinoor, that is the other property, the Kohinoor mill case. Subsequently that was confirmed by the Honorable Supreme Court, Justice Gokhale judgment. Then section 52 is regarding penalty for unauthorized development and or use of land otherwise than conformity with the development plan. So 52 is a prosecution permitted under the MRTP about the unauthorized development or a use of land. Then section 53, can authority has a power to direct the owner of the land or occupier or person who is carrying out that unauthorized construction to remove the unauthorized development. Then notice is given, 1 month period is there. Unauthorized construction or change of user are the subject matter of section 53. Here legislature has provided one safeguard. Under subsection 3 of section 53, the person to whom the notice is given can apply for regularization of the structure. And if such application is made, then till such application is decided, action of under section 53 is automatically suspended, that structure gets protection. So subsection 3 contemplates what is irregular can be regularized. Suppose landlord or a person who has carried out construction, ignorance of law, has done something, but it is permissible under the law. Then he can go to the authority and say that, all right, I made mistake, please regularize me, regularize this construction, take this my application, take whatever penalty charges you want to levy and regularize this construction. One important departure will be, what is illegal can't be regularized, such as, suppose it is constructed in a playground reserved under the development plan. This construction will not be regularized because construction will not be permissible under regular development plan or development control regulations. So what is illegal can't be regularized, what is irregular can be regularized. Then subsection 5, action will depend upon the decision of subsection 3. Consequences of not complying with this notices are prosecution. Here punishment is provided of 1 month. So these are the penal provisions made. And second will be, of course, taking demolition actions as the structure is unauthorized. Under subsection 8, designated officers are notified for exercise of power under 54, 55, 56. Under section 54, power is given to stop unauthorized construction, and if not stopped, prosecutions can be lodged. And section 56 is another notice under the MRTP for removal, discontinuation of unauthorized temporary development, action of removal of temporary structure is taken. Difference between section 53 and 55 is, section 53 is given where structures are permanent, and section 55 is given where structures are temporary. Then section 56 empowers the authorities to require the removal of unauthorized development or use of the land, and any development and use is contrary to that, planning authorities power to take the actions. Then section 56A provides for penal provision, as we are not so much concerned, but this provision, penal provision about illegal structures illegal construction made without permission or additional alterations made, etc. So actions can be taken. So briefly, 351 of the Corporation Act, Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, 354A of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, and these sections 51, 52 to 55, 56 of the MRTP Act permit the authorities to take actions. As far as party is concerned, affected party is concerned, the inbuilt safeguards are provided. If the notice under 53 is given or 55 is given, the party can go to the authority and satisfy that authority that the action contemplated is not called for because of ABC reason. Section 55 was challenged on the ground that it has doesn't give any the guidelines as to how that power can be exercised, and there is no remedy of appeal or revision under Section 55 because Section 149 of the MRTP bars the jurisdiction. The Justice Patel, bench of Justice Patel and Justice Tate, on 4th September 2008 in the writ petition number 51 of 2008 has occasion to consider this, and by relying upon some Supreme Court judgment, they have said section can't be declared as bad only because some provisions are not, inbuilt provisions are not given for the purposes of just like 351. They say that 55 also, the affected party can go to the officer, give his replies, and if replies are not accepted, the affected party can go to the court of law. Therefore, section 55 validity is accepted. Considering both these provisions, 149 of the MRTP and section 151A of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, the civil court jurisdiction is barred. There is always debate, what is that jurisdiction, when suits are maintainable, when the sections are held as a valid sections. A bench of Justice Dharmadhikari and Justice Patel has occasion to consider this grievance under section 150 under the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. Judgment of Justice Dharmadhikari was subsequently followed by Justice Zanda. That judgment will be relevant, writ petition number 2243 of 2013, Yogesh Meghaji Gada versus Mumbai Municipal Corporation. It's dated. There are several writ petitions were filed and disposed of by a common judgment that is dated 10th April 2014. In para 19, learned judge has referred to Justice Oak's judgment, which I will make reference in detail what Justice Oak has said. And para 20, the learned judge has carved out exception that in which circumstances the suit will be maintainable. Because of this section 151A, the litigants started directly filing writ petitions in the Honorable High Court. Justice Dharmadhikari took a view that section, the civil court remedy is not barred if it is without, the action taken is without jurisdiction, is nullity, etc., which Justice Zandar has dealt with in detail thereafter. And then he said that always if there is nullity, it's without jurisdiction, suit can be maintained, and you need not rush to the court. The pleadings in the plaint should indicate that exception is made out for the purposes of filing of the suit, and in that view is reiterated by Justice Zandar in para 20. But I will quote something in para 20. All these decisions should show that the suit would be maintainable in cases where there is jurisdictional error. In case of Shukma, Chandra, etc., that para may be seen in detail. That para will give you details as to how, in what circumstances suit can be filed. I have occasion to see various plaints filed challenging the action under 351 or section 354. But only plainly orders pass are challenged without any making reference to how the civil court will get jurisdiction in the teeth of the section 155, 515A or 149 of the MRTP Act. Therefore, while while drafting the plan, care will have to be taken by you that what will be the scope to say that the suit is maintainable and civil court will have jurisdiction. Justice Zamdar, I will only read 5-6 pages, 5-6 lines. Case that is in para 21, the learned judge has said, case of nullity may arise where there is a lack of jurisdiction at the stage of commencement of inquiry. That is when the authority is assumed under the ultra-virus statute, the tribunal is not properly constituted or is disqualified to act, the subject matter or the parties are such over which the tribunal has no jurisdiction to inquire, and there is want of essential preliminaries prescribed by the law for commencement of the inquiry. The cases of nullity may also arise during the course or conclusion of the inquiry. These cases are also cases for want of jurisdiction. If the case, well, if jurisdiction is understood in a wide sense, some examples of these cases are when the tribunal has wrongly determined the jurisdictional question of fact or law, when it has failed to follow the fundamental principle of judicial procedure, that is, pass the order without giving opportunity of hearing to a party affected, when it has violated fundamental provisions of the Act, when it has failed to take into account the matters which are required to be taken into account, when it has acted in bad faith, when it grants a relief or makes an order which it has no authority to grant or make, when by misapplication of law it has asked itself a wrong question. While drafting the plan, care will have to be taken that something you say on this, that authority has acted, order is nullity, or because of jurisdictional error or without authority, etc., the suit will be maintainable. The procedure in the suit is that if the plan gives the averment, the issue is required to be framed. If the issue is required to be framed, you can leave the evidence as to how the suit is maintainable. So matter goes for trial. With this, I think Section 351 and 354A and 55 of the MRTP Act, I have covered the issues which are required for the purposes of advocates. I have given this lecture for the corporation, saying that what precautions you should take while you are taking actions under 351 or 354. So also, there were advocates of the corporation present. At that time, advice or lecture was, well, discussion was what the advocate should take into account while defending such actions. So I changed a little bit to say that what the plaintiff is supposed to do, what the landlord is supposed to do, and what the remedies are available, what avenues are available to you when you are challenging the action, when you are trying to protect your the notice from the action to be taken in pursuance of these notices. Then one issue which is now lying in the Mumbai jurisdictions, so also other corporations like Thana, Pune, New Mumbai, is of dilapidated buildings. Dilapidated building is Section 354 for Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. Section 354 is read by the parties to mean that only commissioner can ask to pull down the structure. No, it is not so. 354, if the building is more than 30 years old, under 353B, the commissioner can ask the landlord of the building to give the structural audit. So also in regular inspection or complaints received about any building being dilapidated, the visits are made, record is maintained, and depending upon the nature of dilapidated or the scope, I will say so, what is required for that building, whether some part of that building is required to be pulled down or whether that building is required to be repaired by permitting the tenants or occupants to stay inside, or whether building is required to be repaired by vacating it, or building is beyond repair and only way is to pull it down. So 354 is one for repairs, directions can be given, and two, if the repairs are not permissible, it will not be feasible because of the age of the building, cost of the construction, etc., the commissioner can ask the building to be pulled down. For that, now there are categorization, C1 category, C2 category, C3 category, etc. There is a penal provision, 475A and 475B. If notice given are not honored or not complied, there is a prosecution provided and there is a sentence, imprisonment is provided under this provision. One section said that it is a minimum 1 month section, the imprisonment should be given. Justice Khande Parkar judgment, Division Bench at Nagpur, just reference and I will give the relevant paras. 2006, 6 Bombay cases reporter, 413, para 19 and 20. Justice Khande Parkar's bench has said, before taking any action against the structure being dilapidated, the authority must have complete material with it and its act must be bona fide and supported by the record within the file. And once the authority is satisfied, decision is bona fide, then actions are taken and the notice can be given and the scope of the inquiry will be limited. The apprehension appears to be in various cases in Mumbai, allegations are that at the instance of the builder, the actions are being taken, etc. So Justice Khande Parkar's judgment can be used by us, saying that whether the authority has complete material before it, before action is taken, whether decision making process is complete without any fault, and whether the decision taken is in a bona fide, and the interest of the resident of that building or the resident of the locality or the passerby, because pulling that building being fallen down, there should not be injuries, casualties to the persons residing inside, so also passerby or adjoining building. There was a problem faced by the corporation. 354 notice is given, but there was no inbuilt provisions whereby that notice can be taken to logical end, means vacation of that building. People are residing in that building, then what action can be taken, how they can physically remove. In that context, there was non-cooperation from the police, therefore writ petition was filed seeking directions against the government that they should be directed to provide the help in case the corporation wants to take action. When that petition was being argued or debated, parties suggested that yes, there are no doubt that if the building is dilapidated, it has to be the parties residing inside have to vacate it if necessary by force. But before that, there must be some inbuilt safeguard to the resident of that building. Action should not be arbitrary or taken in a bad faith. And in case of inquiry by the court should be able to have material from the authority. In that context, by consent of all the parties appearing in that case, private parties were there, government was there, corporation was there, some scheme was given which was approved by the court at its own direction, saying that what steps you should take while taking action under 354. To summarize this in brief, what Justice Mota has said in reported judgment of 2014 into 6, volume 6, Bombay cases reported 860, para 9, that directions are there. That one, there should be structural engineer's report, there should be inspection report. If the structural report given by the landlord is pointing out towards the structure is required to be pulled down, then the occupants or tenants of that building are required to be given notice, give them time to counter that report by filing separate report. In case of conflict of reports, send the matter to technical advisory committee. The technical advisory committee should consist about some experts of that field from the corporation officers, high ranking officers. 3 officers were named. The technical advisory committee should hear the structural engineers of the landlord and the tenant, and thereafter pass picking order whether the structure is required to be pulled down, one, whether structure can be repaired by keeping the persons inside, or structure can be repaired by removing these people, and which requires major repairs. Therefore, all these parameters setbacks were provided. As there was no policy, the corporation decided to frame the policy, and on 20th January 2018, policy was framed. I'm giving these details so that whenever action is taken, you can check it, whether this policy is being followed. The test laid down or procedure laid down is complied with. As indicated by Justice Mohta, more or less the same, it is same. Structural report of the landlord, then corporation's own survey, copy of the that report to the occupant, time given to the occupant to revert that report if they want. If the conflicting report is given to the corporation, the matter is referred to the technical advisory committee. Then this policy contains as to how the structural audit report or structural report should be formatted, form is prescribed, various tests are given, and all this is required to be given in proper form. There are 6 tests which are required to be given apart from many other tests. This policy says so what this is required to be done. Generally, this is not done by many the structural engineers to say what will be that policy. Just only one para or one part I want to point out that about that policy, because this is a crucial for the purposes of taking actions. I got it. The policy requires that 6 tests are required to be done, more than 6-7, ultrasonic pulse velocity test, rebound hammer test, half cell potential test, carbonation depth test, core test, chemical analysis, cement aggregated ratio, with other formalities which structural engineer is supposed to follow. This gives the idea about the building's structural stability. There can be attack on these reports and the technical advisory committee's finding if the buildings are found to be required to be demolished, etc. That technical advisory committee has not considered this, that or so, or structural audit report given by the landlord has not considered, has not given this report, etc. All this is required to be placed before the court, showing that why that technical advisory committee's decision is not proper. This policy was placed before the High Court, and Justice Oak's bench, in judgment reported in 2018, 5 AR Bombay, reporter 460, has said that we will take this policy on record. They have not said that policy is bad or illegal. Challenge to that policy is kept open. But the judgment goes ahead and says that police machinery has to be provided, assistance must be provided to the commissioner when actions are being taken. That is how the Justice Oak's judgment proceeds, that the corporation is supposed to follow its own policy, and in case the action is required to be taken, then the police machinery should be made available. Scope under 354 is limited for challenge. We have to find out, one, whether there is procedural infirmities, two, whether there is some defects in the process followed by the ward level or by the technical advisory committee level, and three, whether the reports you can challenge or attack. As far as 354 is concerned, suits will be maintainable, and therefore actions can be brought and issue can be joined about the reports being filed before the corporation and the decision of the technical advisory committee. With this, the dilapidated building question can be dealt with. Generally, writs are filed, but the scope of the writ will be limited. The writ jurisdiction will be to see whether proper procedure is followed or whether decision-making process is proper. But under in the suit, everything will be open for you to discuss and consider. You can plead many things in the suit, and being a court of record, the civil court will have to decide, take the evidence on record and decide. Of course, notice of motion stage, you can file your affidavits in support of your plea, that why action is required to be stayed, why the structure is required to be protected, then the suits are decided. Generally, courts are very slow in these actions, because in Mumbai or some parts of this country, Maharashtra, buildings are falling, people, there are casualties. Therefore, courts are very reluctant to intervene and step in. But if possible, you can make out a case saying about the policy. You can utilize the judgment of Justice Khandepalkar saying that decision making process, the authority has no material when decision was taken, etc. With this, I think I have covered the issue of 351, 354, MRTP provisions, so also the dilapidated buildings under 354 of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. With this, I conclude and request the organizers to if anybody has any queries, I'm glad to. Yes, anybody has queries, not related to his personal case, in general, I will try to reply to this. The making, framing of the rules, the procedure is very lengthy. It will have to be first proposed by the administration, then it goes to the general body, then it goes to the urban development department of the state of Maharashtra. Urban development department, they will frame the rules, and for the purposes of approval, it will go before the legislature. So by passage of time, this will be done at some point of time, but at present there are no rules. Therefore, while taking actions, there should be some procedure. All officers must be following some procedure, because there are 24 wards in Mumbai Municipal Corporation. 24 officers can't have 24 procedures. Therefore, for them, there is one procedure prescribed. So also the landlord or the occupants are told as to what precautions they have to take, what defense they can have for such type of actions. In that way, that policy is there. And Justice Oak therefore said that we have take this policy on record, but we have not gone into the legality or validity of that policy.
Some enlightenment on tolerated structures.
Tolerated structures is a concept used all the time. In Mumbai, as far as Bombay is concerned, as everybody knows, from 54 onwards, Bombay started expanding. Otherwise, there were villages. Bandra was municipal council, but beyond Bandra, there were small villages and it was governed by village panchayats. There were no town planning rules or rules which permits the development or which regulates the development. Just like Pune, adjoining gram panchayats, structures are came, but there is no regulation as such to control this. Now there are regulations framed by the government. While expanding the jurisdiction of Mumbai Municipal Corporation, now it has gone up to the Kandivali, Borivali, up to Malad, Mulund, etc. Various gram panchayats were taken inside, and there are no record. There are absolutely no record. So question was, in absence of record, how corporation can say what is illegal and what is legal? Therefore, at that time, the policy makers must have thought it fit that we have some line, some date, whereby residential structure prior to that date, if are shown in existence, will be protected, without making inquiry whether structure is illegal, legal. So also, commercial structures, 1962 is one date and 1963 is a date for commercial activity. If commercial activity is happening prior to 1960, that will be protected. That is called tolerated structures, because by the policy of the corporation, it is tolerated. In Mumbai, going just expanding this tolerated concept, in Mumbai, in 1992-93, committee was appointed to find out how the slums can be removed, because as you know, Bombay, biggest landlords are Mumbai Municipal Corporation, Collector and Mumbai Port Trust, because Bombay is reclaimed. So all reclaimed land waste in the corporation, with the government. There was City Improvement Trust, which was abolished somewhere in 1933 or 35, which has taken over the various properties. There were functions were just like SIDCO or MARA to construct the houses and give it to the citizens on the rent basis or ownership basis. So they acquired the properties. So City Improvement Trust was merged with the corporation. Therefore, corporation became the biggest landlord. As there were vacant lands with these authorities, these slums have come. 1976 Act came, where slum was declared. Slums are declared, about various provisions are there. We need not go into the details. But 42%, one data says, 42% Mumbai is in slums. And much more population stays in the slum. And slums are provided with basic amenities free of charge. There is no taxation, property taxation. Water is free, electricity is free. So also other utilities are free. So always there is a debate as to why a person staying in the legal structure should share the burden or infrastructure which is required to be paid by the corporation on illegal structures or slums. Government has said from time to time, 1195 we will protect. Prior to that, we will give protections and they will be rehabilitated. I am told now by passage of time, it has come up to 2015. So, maybe we are not a political person to address. The policy makers thought it fit that the development has to be developed in a planned manner, but development has taken place in an unplanned manner. And therefore, that has to be regulated, regularized, and the citizen must be given some shelter on some roof for his family. Coming back, I should have told to this gathering, Section 52A was amended, MRTP Act was amended. And all structures prior to 2013, I think December 2013 is the date, were legalized, exception is carved out where it is in no development zone, etc., etc. That was debate. Section 52A was challenged before this court. Justice Oak and Justice Menon bench, I appeal for state of Maharashtra. Section was protected. Section is said to be valid, but some rules are struck down. For your purpose, I can share this information. While striking down the rules, the judgment quotes wrong rules. The rules which are final rules approved by the state legislature and the rules quoted by the judgment in the judgment doesn't match. Matter is in the Supreme Court. I appealed in the Supreme Court. The appeal is admitted and matter is pending for stay. When we say the policy makers, there is a lengthy debate that this was argued by me, the constitution mandates that the resident citizens of this country must get food and shelter. Right of education, right of shelter, right of food, acts are framed. So what shelter you are having, you are, can't be taken up. As far as possible, if you can regularize it without damaging the development plans, without creating burden on infrastructure, if this is permissible mode, by penalizing these people, you can regularize these structures. That was argument advanced, because this is not only problem faced by our country, These are faced problems all over country. Maybe in Europe or modern developed countries this problem will be less, but this problem is everywhere. So coming back, as constitutional mandates, the citizen must be given shelter, because you are expanding the scope of Article 21. You are expanding the scope of Article 14. So also you are expanding the scope. Well, I say, when it was argued by me, I said that citizen has constructed a shelter which the state feels it can be regularized, it can be protected. State is not able to give him shelter. Then shelter constructed by that citizen, family, why I should take it out if I am able to regularize it? There are international conventions which state India is party. There are various schemes therefore coming, Prime Minister Awas Yojana or all these Yojanas, etc. They are matters flowing from that. And government is key that shelter should be provided. With this, the planning is there. Illegal things can't be regularized, but as far as possible, it can be protected. One more I can add is, in Pune or adjoining districts, the non-agricultural lands are used for construction. Small pieces, Guntewari, what is called. But problem faced by why these people are constructing, when otherwise this development is permissible, because of our some acts which are such a rigid that a person who can, a owner, forefather's land, I want to construct a 500 square feet roof on my head, I have to first get it converted to non-agriculture. That non-agriculture taxes are so much that it is much more than the land value. So people say that all right, instead of paying that any taxes, I construct within that budget. That's how the illegal structures have come up. And government is trying to protect it. That's how tolerated structure, time to time it is protected. Up to 15 it will be protected. Private lands, 13 it is protected by section 52A. And government, semi-government organizations, etc. This is protection is 2015, and by the passage of time, it will be 2020. When election will come, it will be 20. For corporation, Mumbai corporation specifically, only mode available is Maharashtra Regional Town Planning Act, read with section 337, 347, etc., which I pointed out. Read with development control regulation. So regulation, now online provision is made. So you can track your application. Applications are required to be made by the license surveyor. This some procedure is there, but it is mainly MRTP Act, read with development control regulation, read with Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. And there is no separate authority as such for the Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act. Ullasnagar, maybe, because Ullasnagar, when it came, it was a, people migrated in 1947 partition, large scale development has taken place, people are to be permitted to stay, mainly Ullasnagar is city established for these people, therefore there may be some regulatory authority for one, for regulating the construction activity, and two, for that evacuee properties, that may be. That is how our people in assembly has to take a call. Your local representative have to take a call. Therefore, I said that it's a for planning, it's a for policy decisions as to how it should be regularized. But generally, the government tries to intervene, protect the parties by the taking steps. As far as possible, government is soft toward these illegal constructions. The Prime Minister should be. Yeah. The protection provided in the policy itself. First thing, before demolition, the building, the rooms or flats area is measured in presence of the landlord and the tenant. And certificate is given to both, saying that this much is the area available. The IOD clause, intimation of disapproval, clause says that unless you have agreement with the tenants, a particular percentage of the agreements, your building plan will not be sanctioned. So, corporation has taken a care that if that building comes for that land comes for redevelopment. A building is proposed on that plot, the tenant's right is protected. That is the policy. There will be the debate as to whether corporation can push such condition, etc. But as far as possible, courts are accepting that, and courts are saying that you entered into the agreement with the tenants and protect the tenants' interest, even transit rate, etc., etc. Recently, if I don't mistake, there is a provision in this development control regulation of 2034 also about this. So also, the cess buildings, MADA cess buildings, constructed prior to 1940. There are additional incentives given to the landlord, to the developer, so that he can construct the tenements for the tenants. He can sell the surplus area. He can give something to the MADA. And in that, the balance is tried to be adjusted. Tenants are protected, landlord is protected, so also MADA is protected. So protection is there. They are not kept high and dry. I think these questions are over. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sakhare sir, for the very, very enlightening and informative and very practical lecture, because all the issues that normally us lawyers face are really addressed by you in your lecture. We are really thankful to you. And now I call upon Mr. Sriram Reddy to propose a vote of thanks.
Firstly, I thank Senior Advocate Mr. Anil Sakhare for his illustrative lecture. The issue of dilapidated buildings and as well as the illegal construction, though it is a menace, it has some humanitarian issues also involved. And while representing our clients, many varied facts come before us, and we have to address those facts and give our client as far as possible the justice in the court of law. So all those tips and insights provided by our learned speaker today are very, very useful. I found them very useful, and I hope that all of us gathered here must have found them, all those tips, very useful for our day-to-day practice. I thank the president of AWI for the cooperation, as well as Mr. Kuldeep Patil, who is a secretary of the AWI. I also thank the staff of the AWI for the arrangement. I thank Srimati Trupti Loke for the videography she is providing us, and you will be soon viewing this on YouTube. It will be uploaded to YouTube. I also thank all of you friends for gathering here, and I also thank all our karyakartas of Adhivakta Parishad for all the arrangements they have made and the pains they have taken to make this lecture series entirely successful. And I request all of you to rise for the Vande Mataram, and after Vande Mataram, national anthem. I'm sorry.
Janagana Mana Adhinayaka Jayahe Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindhu Gujarat Maratha Dravida Uttala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Ashisha Mage Gaye Tava Jaya Gatha Janagana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He, Jaya 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 He.
Thank you everyone, please follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. We also upload these lectures, videos of these lectures on our YouTube channel. Please subscribe to us. Thank you so much for this. Yes, sir.